everybody. I'm here with aspiring Ashley, and we're here at the Brookline Booksmith for the signing with Susan Dennard and
V.E. Schwab.
We were supposed to be here much earlier, but we got distracted by delicious Mediterranean food. And the event starts at 7. We didn't get here till 7:15. There are no seats left, and we're kind of in standing room only.
Standing next to a trash can.
But I don't know how much vlogging I'm going to be able to do, but we're going to try to actually vlog as much as we can.
Yes.
Please join me in welcoming Susan Dennard and V.E. Schwab.
I wanted to be an interrogator. Like legitimately. Well, I mean, I wanted to be Sydney Bristow from Alias, but barring that, I wanted to be an interrogator. Yeah. And in some ways, writing is kind of like not super far from that. I actually went to school originally for astrophysics.
Wow.
Changed my major 6 times. And over the course of changing it so many times, realized that what I actually loved was the narrative. I loved learning about a subject and then moving on because the course catalog was like 300 pages long.
Wow.
How could I possibly study one thing? And that actually was one of my first indicators I was going to be a writer. Because the cool thing about writing is that you get to become an expert in something and dive into a world and a life for a short period of time. Right. So how about you, Susan? Because you had marine biology.
Yeah, well, first I want to know, have you always written, though? Like, did you start writing?
I started telling stories when I was quite young. The first story I ever finished, I was 8, and I wrote a story, this is so indicative, about the angel of life and the angel of death who were brothers, and then the angel of death got super jealous because everyone loved the angel of life, and so he murdered the angel of life, and then the world ended because there was no life. And I was 8, so I knew I was going to tell stories, but I didn't know what shape the stories were going to take until I was in college.
I can tell you the shape. I am a writer for lots of reasons. I always told stories too, mm-hmm. and daydream constantly, never stop daydreaming. And the struggle for me is actually the writing part.
Really?
Like, I want you guys to know the stories. I wish you could just pull them out of my head and we'd be done with it. Everything. Oh my gosh.
What's a story you wish you? Because I know
Jonathan
my
Strange and Mr.
Oh, that feelings.
Is, like, the book I wish I had written and thought of.
Yeah.
And since I can't, I'll just reread it over and over and over again and be that annoying person who knows it too well.
What's that?
Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell.
I love Neil's work. The Neverwhere is actually my favorite of his books, but Graveyard Book is the one that I wish I had written just because, like, it speaks straight to my heart. I don't know what it is. It's that perfect combination of story and feeling, and I love that book so much. I reread it, and I don't often reread books. Actually, the reason that my bookshelves are in color is because I don't reread. So for me, I have a library complex. Like, I need to own the books, but I probably won't reread them. I loan them out and stuff. And so because of that, the books can be in color-coded order. I'm not worried about losing them. Yeah. So I'm very not woo-woo about writing, meaning, like, I don't believe that characters talk through me. I am the god of my tiny world. I tell them what to do and who to be, and I execute it. And I know from the very beginning how my books end. I write the endings first and work backwards to figure out who my characters need to be at the start. All of that applies to everything except names. For me, I was unnamed for the first 2 weeks of my life. My parents, I was, like, actually unnamed on the birth certificate. They went back to the hospital because they wanted to live with me a little bit first. And that's kind of how I approach characters. I don't start writing a character until I have their name, but their name is something that has to fit their personality. Every now and then I do a name for a specific reason. Like, in the archive series, Mackenzie Bishop is Mackenzie because I needed a female name that shortened to a masculine monosyllable. Mackenzie to Mac, right? But most of the time, names just have to feel right for the character. What about you?
I totally agree, but I want to pause. The writer in me is like, what? You write the end first? I think that's amazing. So do you write it in with a series? Would you have written this end or just the end of the book first?
So before I started A Darker Shade of Magic, I knew exactly how A Darker Shade of Magic ended, and I knew exactly how A Conjuring of Light ended.
So did you work backwards from A Conjuring of Light too?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, we have to talk later.
Okay, wait, but how do you name your characters?
Okay, so because I'm writing a fantasy world that is like a different world completely, I had to make up different cultures, and I'm totally go all in on world building. It's like my favorite part. Also a great procrastination technique. So I have all these cultures that I built, and they each have their linguistic roots, and the names are based from that. It's super dorky, but it's fun for me, and I think it works. Like, I did have someone who was an archaeology professor, and she was like, I could tell that you really worked at those names. It felt so real historically. I was like, yes, I did it! I don't know who I would want to hang out with. They would probably all try to kill me.
Right?
I mean, like, I have to say, like, Sophie in this Witchlands has my sense of humor. It's very punny, so she would probably crack me up, but... she's also kind of like way too impulsive, and it would drive me crazy because I'd be like, girl, grow a brain. I don't know. That's a very hard question. I've never actually been asked who would I want to hang out with. So you probably have a good answer.
No, I would probably say Prince Rye, because he's one of the only characters that, like, one wouldn't try to stab me. Like, I always joke that rather than me hang out with them, I really want Delilah Bard from the Shades of Magic series to hang out with Victor Vale, who's the head of Vicious.
Do you want to go first?
I made a huge mistake. I kept my name, and I shouldn't have. Like, I really wish I'd used a pseudonym now. Just because, like, you get... It's weird when your real life crosses over with this life. So, like, someone in my real life, like my doctor, will be like, I looked you up online and read your book. And I'm like, no, you're not supposed to know about that. And so I, like, wish I hadn't done that. So there you go. There you go. My name is not pronounceable. Like, no one ever says it right, which is fine. I say Dennard, but most people say Dennard, which is probably the correct way to say it. But my family's from Redneck, Georgia, so we turned it into Dennard. And so it's, like, just one of those, like, it's not, like, that annoying, but I just wish I'd gone something easy. Like, my middle name is Towers. I should have just been Susan Towers. Although, for the record, for a laugh, guys, my initials are STD. Everybody laugh. I got it sewn on my backpack in junior high. That's how I figured out what they were. I went to school, and my nickname became Herpes. When I say nickname, I mean the bullies. So, yeah. I never lived it down. It was the worst day of my life. Anyway, so don't use the initials STD as your writing name. Pro tip.
I have two names. So I'm Victoria on my Kidlit NYA, and I'm a VE on my adult novels. And the reason is super fun. The reason is that adult genre is super sexist, and the number of fans, like fans of my series, specifically female fans, who tell me, I love it when this happens, if you're thinking this, please don't tell me, who tell me that they never would have picked up my book if they'd known I was a woman.
No.
It happens a lot.
It's a lot. Sexism is a really, really big issue in adult fantasy. And so I would rather someone pick up my book and read it and like it and then have to deal with my gender than to never pick up my book because it said Victoria on the cover. So yeah, I'm VE. I actually kind of wish all my stuff was VE though. I like having a short name. My real name is Victoria Elizabeth. It is a lot of syllables.
It is.
A lot of syllables. And so I love it actually. I wanted to go with something simpler because no one can pronounce Schwab, but my father threw an absolute conniption.
Really?
I'm an only child, and like this is like a man who has total chill most of the time. And when I said that I wanted to change my name on the book covers to something, like, had it been a pseudonym, I think he'd be fine, but like to just change my last name, no. No. So it's fine. I'm cool with people mispronouncing it, but yeah, it's like not a super cool reason to have to do something. And my editor is very like, F the patriarchy, like you should have it on the cover. But I would rather take down patriarchy from the inside out. And so if it means that I convert readers and then they have to kind of deal with their feelings towards things, then that's fine with me.
And I, with my new series, had a lot of say. My first series was with Harper Teen, and I did not have any say. And it's a pretty cover, like no, this is not dissing the designer or the model on it, but it just is not reflective of the story inside at all. Like, nothing about a girl in a dress screams steampunk Ghostbusters and zombies. So I like maybe cried a little bit when I got it, and that was that. It's a big publisher. They don't have time to care what the author thinks. It's not personal. It's just business. Tor, who we're both with, is much smaller as a publisher. And they are way more able to listen to what we want. And so I know, like, people on covers aren't necessarily all that popular, but that's what I love, because, like, when I was a kid and growing up reading, like, the books I went for were the ones on fantasy with a girl on the front, you know? Like, Anne McCaffrey, Girl on a Dragon, I was like, I'm there! So that's kind of what I was thinking about, was like, well, I want to be, my ideal reader is 13-year-old me, so who just wants to get away from being called herpes at school.
Historically, most authors don't get a lot of say on their covers, and historically I haven't. But with the Shades of Magic series, so Darker Shade, I got a little bit of say, and then it's increased with each book. So before they started designing these books, they came to me and they basically said, do you want to go classically, like, illustrated cover a la, like, Brandon Sanderson? Like, the painted fantasy artwork? No. And that was the thing. And I came back and I was like, no. I was like, I want something that looks like a poster. Like, I want something that you could see not just in the fantasy section of the bookstore, but that would, like, catch your eye if it was face out in main general fiction. Like, because that's the thing about my books. I always say that my books are, like, character books that just happen to, like, be shrouded in something fantastical. So I loved the direction that Will Stolle came up with for A Darker Shade of Magic, and I was so excited when I first saw it, because I was like, this is going to look so good with the series format. So then Gathering came out, and I got a little bit of say. They showed me, like, four different covers, and I picked the one with the upward-reaching hands. And my original undergraduate background is in book design, so I'm super finicky, right? And they figured that out. They sent me, like, 20 iterations of the cover and let me pick every single detail of it. And it was such a wonderful experience, because, like I say, that is not common. The one thing that's nice is, like, I might not have gotten creative control on a lot of my books, but at least now I'm a few books in, they'll, like, let me have a say, and I can just outright veto. So, and, like, by veto, I mean, like, lay down on the floor and throw, like, a tiny, tiny tantrum. And they know this because I'm not a high drama author. You can ask me to gut my entire book and I will do it for you, but I go in, and every time I start a new publishing relationship, I tell them I'm gonna be amazing, like, I'm not gonna be hardcore at all on anything, we're gonna have a great time until we get to covers, and then I'm going to be a nightmare child, and I'm so sorry. But again, like, your name is the thing on the front of that cover, you're the one that it's attached to. And it's important. And I think publishers work with so many covers, they don't always get how important it is to the author. So yeah, I'm very, very lucky. I've now told Will that I'm kidnapping him, and he's got to do all of my cover illustrations forever and ever, because I love him so much. That's a big question. I got into a conversation with my agent today for about an hour and a half around the question of how. Because I have a minimum of 3 books out in 2019. And that I'm working on right now, and I'm working on a graphic novel, and I'm working on comics, and I'm highly involved in the screenwriting side of, like, my book's adaptations, and I write a lot. I'm actually quite a slow writer, but I'm a consistent writer. I believe in keeping the door propped open every single day. I can only write one book at a time, but I can also plan a book at the same time, and I can edit a book at the same time. So I budget it pretty strictly. I don't take days off. Yeah. It's a 365-day-a-year job. Like, I would rather, this is a philosophy that is getting me in trouble, I would rather be overwhelmed than underworked. I was at a point a couple years ago in my career where I was very, very afraid I would never work again. And so I said yes to a lot of stuff. And I'm still saying yes. I had to say no for the first time today to something very difficult. And saying no is very scary as a creative person, but I love it. Like, I love being busy. Ask me that when I'm laying on the floor and it's 2 a.m. and I'm crying and I probably would say no. But, like, I'm just happy that way. It's just my jam. If I'm not busy enough, I get nothing done. If I have 2 hours to write, I will make use of those 2 hours. And if I have 12 hours, I will make use of 12 hours. So I just can only make sure I have 2 hours.
Yeah. I'm not as efficient as she is. So everything she said, whoa. I have nothing helpful to offer you.
All right, so the talk is now over, and we're playing the waiting game. And if you want to see what I'm talking about. And there's no real line. So we're just going to attempt to somehow make our way towards Victoria and Susan. I have no idea. We snagged a couple of, like, front row seats, and we're just gonna, we're trying to, like, oh no, I wanna go this way to show you. Haha! Opposites. So we're just gonna wait this out until everyone kind of clears out, and then we're going to have, you know, our book signed. I'm just, we're not dealing with this nonsense. No. That's not happening.
I'd rather be tired for work tomorrow.
Me too. Me too. We now have an author out in the wild. It looks like you're petting her butt, because that's where, yeah, how it lines up with the camera. Yeah, Susan is actually just going into the line to try to move things along, and bless her. Bless her.
We're still going to just sit here and hope that she comes our way.
Yeah, basically. Yeah, yeah. She's not going to leave until everybody's done anyway.
The end is near. Look at all this empty space. Look at all this empty space. I'm so excited for this.
So the lighting is really bad, but I'm finally home. The time is...
It is about 11:30 at night, so we're gonna do this super fast because I kind of want to just go to bed. I got both. The lighting's not so good. Let me turn this up, actually. Oof. And look, we have light. I got The Windwitch by Susan Dennard. Truth Witch, which is book two in the series. And they're both signed. Oh, she didn't sign it there. Oh, see? Look, she signed it. Conjuring of Light, which is the last book in the series. And the first book, A Darker Shade of Magic. I had gotten book two at the Boston Teen Author Festival. And it felt weird to have book two and book three and not book one. So I now have a full series that's also signed. So that's actually really satisfying and rather glorious.
Yep, so that's it. That was my entire evening. I am really exhausted, really tired. We basically waited for a good like couple hours to be seen because we just didn't want to bother with that line. That line was just horrendous, and I feel like the bookstore should have a better system. But overall, a fun evening. Both Susan and Victoria were super nice because we were the last people to be seen and to have our book signed. So they were just super nice. And all the workers at the bookshop, they were rock stars, especially staying that late. So I have work in the morning. I'm going to go to bed. I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and I hope to see you guys in the next one. Bye, guys!